Okay, I wanted to welcome everyone to the Amberley Information Meeting this evening. I'm Tom Uthing. I'm the mayor of Amberley Village. Just a couple introductions first. Over here are the council members that are able to attend this evening. Rich Bardak is on the far right, Alita Kamine, Peg Conway, and Ed Hattenbach. On my left is the chief, on the far left, everyone probably knows, and village manager Scott Longer. What tonight is about is we've been trying as a council, we committed as a council to really try to ensure that we communicate on a regular basis to our residents about various matters. And we've been trying to hold sessions like this at least every couple years. This is the third one that I can remember during my 4.5 years on council. So that we are going to talk tonight about really three primary subjects. One, finances, and this will serve as an update of a subject that we're trying to regularly update our residents on. The chief will talk about policing in the village and what's been going on and the state of that. And then I will talk about land development and specifically the issues going on at Amberley Green, the former swim club site, which we call the North Site. And if you've seen in the press lately, the former Gibson greeting card site. And then finally, we will talk a little bit about this proposed Duke gas pipeline project, but there's also been a lot of meetings on that, and there will be other meetings on that. So, and then at the end of this session, we will have time for question and answer. So as we go through individual sessions, be that finance or police or whatever, accumulate your questions, and then we'll get to the questions at the end. So with that as an introduction, I will turn it over to our village manager to talk about finances.
Thank you, Mayor. It's always a great opportunity to talk about finances to the residents. It's something that we began, as the mayor mentioned, a few years ago. When we convened here in October of 2011, the purpose was to inform you, our residents, about the village's finances. And we were also looking for input, which we received, and that helped shape the financial course that we embarked upon. So now one of the last slides that we left you with in October 2011 was this slide. This was one that recognized what our financial needs were at that time. The emphasis was to replace lost revenue due to lost and decreased funding sources. It was also intended to fund our operations to eliminate the deficit and to also pay the debt for Amberley Green. Well, in 2012, the village received significant inheritance tax dollars in the amount of $5.3 million, and Village Council decided to apply the $5.3 million along with $900,000 of our reserve monies, and we paid off Amberley Green. So the property is free from mortgage as well as debt. So Amberley Green is paid off. So to simplify the slide, totally took off the Amberley Green debt from the equation. And that leaves us with the need for between $1.5 and $1.7 million. So where have we been and where are we now? So this slide shows how we ended each of the 5 years with our general fund, which the general fund is the one that funds the majority of services throughout the village. So for the first one, 2011, we had a $700,000 deficit. Second year, in 2012, we had a $1.1 million deficit. That $1.1 million deficit was primarily due to the $900,000 we took out of our reserves to pay off Amberley Green debt. So that explains that a bit. Now, the police levy was approved in March of 2012, and that saved the village financially, but it was a very multi-pronged approach that really got us where we're at today. But to continue on, in 2013, the village ended with a positive of $936,000. And then something similar in 2014, $1.1 million. We had another positive situation. And then in 2015, we ended the year in the black at $379,000. So you can see the progress that has been made there. I mentioned it's a multifaceted approach. The police levy was a significant part of that, but there's other things that were occurring at the time and continue even today. So the first item I want to talk about is the credit that needs to go to council and then to the employees for facilitating the cost-conscious culture that has been implemented, which has changed how the village looks at spending. So this principle is being more vigilant with tax dollars, and that has been pervasive throughout the organization, and that has helped us achieve the better financial footing that we're currently on. A second item I wanted to mention is we have collectively joined with other communities, and we have bid out various services and commodities. For example, waste collection, street resurfacing, road salt, along with other equipment purchases. So this collaboration helps the village realize savings with other communities, and I'll give you an example of that. Residents are currently enjoying a reduced rate for waste collection, and that was achieved through bidding it out with other entities throughout the Southwest Ohio area. So it's where we took advantage of that collaborative approach with other communities. Now, the village is always looking for either new or enhanced revenue streams. For example, the village formed the Joint Economic Development Zone with Sycamore Township, which enables Sycamore Township to tax parts of their unincorporated areas, and the village shares in 10% of the revenues. So this was an opportunity where Village Council used our tax collection abilities and assisted another community while at the same time generating revenue for the village. Last year, that generated $119,000 to Amberley Village. So very worthwhile effort to join those efforts. And we have also leveraged a radio tower that is located on our what we call the north site, which is the property just on the north side of Ronald Reagan that the village owns. That property has a radio tower on it, so it's generating rental from cell tower usage. And last year, that total was $90,000 for that particular cell tower, so pretty significant revenue source for one tower. Now, after not buying cruisers in 2010, 11, and 12, the village did buy used police cruisers in 2013, and this was in order to lower our maintenance expense. Now, since then, we have continued to replace high-mileage cruisers with new cruisers to contain our maintenance costs. We have also restructured and reduced staff in the police and maintenance departments. Our full-time staffing numbers are down from 3 years ago with two less police positions, one less police supervisory position, and one less personnel in the maintenance department. And Chief Wallace will talk a little bit about this further in his presentation this evening. Well, staff has closely monitored the expenses to conserve costs. I think we have become more efficient. We've reduced expenses, and I think we put tax dollars to better use. For example, a dump truck was replaced after getting 16 years of service life out of it when it was expected to only get about 10 years of life. So we're trying to use things to their full extent. We have continued a greater focus on business expansion, with the village identifying any impediments for existing businesses and encouraging them to expand their business. The village has 7 industrialized businesses, and we have very close relationship with each of them, since it's critical because their employees add to our tax base. So those employees that are working there are paying the full 2% to the village. So that's a critical that we have a good relationship and encourage those businesses to continue great operations and expand. You may recall a few years ago we did incentivize topics on Section Road to expand, and they did by 33,000 square feet. And then they also invested about $4 million into their facility, and that increased their payroll, which meant that increased the earnings tax coming into the village. The village has also become very aggressive in pursuing grants, primarily for police, fire, and capital items. There aren't many dollars available for operating costs or for personnel, but so we've honed in on those three areas, and the chief will talk more about the success of those grants in his presentation. Now, there's not one particular item on here that has been the panacea, but certainly combined, it certainly has put the village on a more firm financial ground. So how are we doing? Well, we are much healthier financially than we were 5 years ago. We have ended the last 3 years with a positive balance, and we project future positive operating balances as well. And deficit spending, which I showed you in the first 2 years, is a thing of the past. However, the police levy only covers 60% of the police operating expenses. So the 10 mils that you pay towards the police levy has to be subsidized with over $1 million that needs to come from the general fund to fully pay police expenses. Now that $1 million competes with money that is needed to replace our equipment, to maintain our infrastructure like your streets and your curbs, your brush and your leaf removal, and other village services. So there is demand for that money. So to give you some details about how we are doing, I want to take a look at two major revenue sources and how they're tracking. So the first one is the property tax. So this chart shows property tax going back from 2007 to what we have budgeted for 2016. Our assessed value is the driving determination of property tax for the village. The county auditor is the one that determines that, and that's based on the value of all of your properties. That ends up being the village's value. So as you can see from this particular chart, the property tax collections declined after 2011. That was the banner year, pretty much right there. So it reflects what occurred throughout Hamilton County. We were not unique in this situation, but it generates, that's the issue with that is because it declined after 2011, it generates less dollars for the village. So the county is the one that collects the property tax, and they submit that to us twice a year. So this year we're expecting about $944,000 for the property tax. But our largest source of revenue is the earnings tax. So here's a chart that reflects earnings tax from 2007 to what we have budgeted for 2016. So it is our largest source of funding, and earnings tax collections seem to have stabilized after reductions in 2009 and in 2011. And earnings tax collection in our community tends to fluctuate, as you can see from the chart here. For example, in 2014, we collected over $3 million in earnings tax. The next year, 2015, it dropped to $2.7 million. Now this year appears to be a banner year for us as collections have been much stronger than anticipated. Now this is somewhat of a timing issue in terms of when folks pay their taxes or when businesses submit their taxes to us. But certainly the collections are on track to exceed the $2.6 million that was budgeted this year. But this is something that we continue to monitor to identify if this is an anomaly or if there's something else that is occurring with the earnings tax collections. So I mentioned the general fund, which is where the bulk of our services are funded from. The village has typically had a significant balance, positive balance in its general fund, and that is reflected in this particular slide. And it's a good business practice to have a healthy reserve, and as you can see from the chart, the balance began to be eroded from 2007 to 2012. So it topped out at $6.8 million in 2007, and by 2012, it had reached the level $1.8 million. So pretty low from a village standpoint. Now, as of April 30th, we have a balance of $4.4 million in our general fund. Now, some folks may wonder why we have a positive balance in our general fund, why it's important to keep that as a healthy reserve. There are four basic reasons. One, a fiscal year is just an artificial constraint that we use in order for budgeting purposes, to control dollars, and certainly for financial reporting. So in other words, our expenses don't stop when we start a new year. So it's important to have carryover, because as I mentioned about the property tax that we receive from the county, we receive that twice a year. So our first allotment is in April, and the second allotment is in October. So there's quite a few months there where we're going without money. So that's one of the reasons why we have that fund balance. The second is a strong positive balance assists the village in financing large capital expenditures, which allows us to plan ahead. So it allows us to stay out of debt. And we currently have no debt here in the village, which is a great thing. Third is that the balance that is that we have in the general fund can be invested. So a very good investment can provide revenue to us, so it becomes another revenue source for the village, albeit rates are not all that great right now for the village and for most everybody. So we're not seeing the huge amounts of dollars, but it is another revenue source. Once again, it's a multi-pronged approach to solving our financial issues. And then lastly, the positive balance becomes our contingency fund to respond to unforeseen or unanticipated events or emergencies. So it is critical to keep a healthy fund balance in our general fund. The long-term financial health of the village was the driving force behind the preparation of the financial sustainability report that council was asked to adopt in June of 2013. So long-term financial planning was the focus after the council adopted a balanced 2013 budget, and that's when we brought revenue and expenses together. But what was missing from that 2013 budget was the allocation of funding for significant costs that have been postponed or delayed, which have to be taken into consideration for our future years. Now, some examples of this would include infrastructure, the repaving of streets, purchase of rolling stock, trucks, and various equipment that we have put on hold. But overall, the financial sustainability report shows that the village's financial condition is good, but it reinforces our need for allocating capital dollars for infrastructure as well as equipment. This particular document, I bring this to your attention because it is being updated this summer, and this will be used to provide financial guidance in decision making and establishing budget slash policy decisions that council will be making. Now, one key component of that financial sustainability report was the road condition assessment. And it was very insightful because the road condition assessment revealed that while 85% of our lane miles were in fair to good condition, 15% were in poor condition. But what's interesting is 58% of the cost comes from the 15% that are in poor condition. So you don't want your streets to get into that poor condition because you have to invest so much more money to bring them up to the standards. So the financial sustainability report identified the need for approximately $13 million for capital needs over the 7-year period. So our streets need significant attention to keep them in good condition because it does have an effect on the entire village. And this requires us to use additional general fund dollars to supplement our street dollars. So in summary, the village's financial health is improved, and it's clearly having a dedicated stream of funding for the police department has helped immensely. And if not for the police levy, the village's general fund would be in a deficit situation. And because voters approved, the police department has continued its high level of service to the residents and kept our community safe. Another component here is after investing more than $3.3 million in stormwater infrastructure, last year the village council reduced our stormwater fee by 30%, thereby decreasing the cost to residents, and that is reflected in your utility bill from Greater Cincinnati Water Works. So you got a 30% reduction this past year. Now our challenges continue to be financial prudence as the village strategizes on, one, how to keep our infrastructure and capital assets in the best condition. In other words, how do we come up with the $13 million for street improvements? Second, to plan for our financial future. And third is to continue to deliver our services in the most cost-effective and efficient manner. Now, we will be challenged financially by the relocation of jobs from Procter & Gamble on Sunnybrook Drive. You may have heard that they outsourced the jobs at the P&G facility. So those jobs have moved to Milford. And they're also going to be financially challenged by Saturday Night Limited's relocation to Cincinnati. They currently occupy the former Gibson Greeting Card building. So both of these will have a financial impact on the village and need to be taken into consideration as we prepare for our financial future. Now, Mayor Muthing will be talking later about the redevelopment of the former Gibson Greeting Card site and how that will affect the building, the village as well. So I've given you a snapshot of what our financial history has been the last 5 years and where we currently stand as of today. And so now to illustrate how our police department has lived into that plan is Chief of Police and Fire, Rich Wallace, to speak about our police department.
Let me get that mic. Scott provided me a copy, but I'm still in denial of needing reading glasses, so three slides to a page will not work. So I'll be the first to admit it. Thanks for coming. Thanks for listening. Basically, I'm just going to talk about four basic topics. At the end, there'll be questions and stuff after the mayor talks if you have questions toward me or anyone else on the panel. We're going to talk about department staffing, the grants that we received through 14, 15, and 16, the criminal activity and the police patrols, as well as the culture of the department. We actually began our reconstruction of the police department back in 2012. We knew fiscally the village, we had to make some changes, and we were trying to figure out what's the best way to do that. So the best way was to start from the beginning and go through different things within the department. One of the key things we did was we reduced the department by two personnel through attrition. That way no one lost their job. But we were able to do that without cutting any patrols or anyone even recognized we did that. We did that through scheduling and actually was a great benefit to the department. That itself saved the village $185,000 annually by making that adjustment. Keep forgetting to hold the clicker here. During the restructure, since we were doing the restructure of everybody, we had to look at the command staff. At one point, the command staff consisted of a chief, four lieutenants, and a sergeant. Well, on the fire side, we probably need more command than we do on the police side, since we do both. But we had to figure out what's the most cost-effective way and what's the best operation for the police department. Well, with our hierarchy before, we have a chief, four lieutenants, and a sergeant. It really shows no hierarchy. You go up from sergeant, who do you go to? Who do you pick? So what we did through retirements, along with the attrition of personnel, we left Lieutenant Bloom in his position as a lieutenant, and then anyone else that was promoted, they were promoted to the rank of sergeant. Why is that significant? It's significant because the difference between the sergeant and lieutenant is $7,000 apiece. So by making the adjustment from sergeant to lieutenant is a $21,000 savings to the residents. At that point, we were able to staff each shift with a first, second, and third shift with a sergeant, as well as two administrative personnel as myself and Lieutenant Bloom. And at that point, I decided to eliminate the sixth position, which was another would have been another sergeant or lieutenant position. That itself was another $7,000 savings that we're gonna receive, you know, save us annually. The next step was looking at, we have personnel assigned to a CLIA, which is our accreditation process. We've been accredited since 1993. It was a great process. It helped us form who we are and what we are as a department. CLIA was a good thing. It helped us with our policy procedures. It helped us with, you know, the operation, a lot of different things. But when we started going over it, CLIA actually had 488 different standards that we had to follow. Over the years, they began dropping that number down because small agencies such as ours were dropping out because it wasn't cost effective for the community. And it literally was down to five agencies in the country that actually did it, our size. When we went through the standards that they actually had in place, there was 191 of them. Of the 191 standards, every one of the standards were regulated by one of these groups, whether it be the Attorney General's Office, the Ohio Revised Code, or what everything else up there. But also, the governor put an advisory board in place, which is a collaborative. What actually helps you if you need to change a procedure, you have more access to get to those things to, you know, make your department, you know, corrections. You have to submit annual reports on the collaborative. Everything we did with accreditation, but the only difference is we save $9,500 a year. With that $9,500 every third year, when we went for our reaccreditation, it would cost us an additional $5,000. So this was just another cost-saving measure we made. It didn't impact the department, and we continue to operate the way we do. So it's a combination of these changes with staff and the CLIA process. This itself saved the village on an annual basis. It's saving us about $213,000. The next part is our police and fire grants. In the past history of Amberley, we never took the time to put somebody involved working on grants. The money was out there. We knew that other departments were doing it, but we didn't do it. We have a resident, Sandy Pywin, who's here today, but also Officer Chris Fritch. They work together, you know, hours and hours to get things done. She notifies when there's grants. If it's something we can use, we go for it. So what you see here is there's different grants here, and I just put them up to see the different types. In 2014, when we were down on personnel, it was going to cost us more in overtime to cover the shifts, so we put in for an overtime grant. Attorney General's office for identifying people in the field that give us false names. We got our mobile fingerprint unit we can take out. Recently, our biggest grant we've received is $171,000, a FEMA grant to replace our self-contained breathing apparatus that the fire department wears. We actually received $7,000 to purchase a new police canine. I know I hear positives and negatives about getting a police canine in Amberley. Is there a need for it? Is there not a need for it? But in reality, with the surrounding communities and the things changing around us, the dynamics and the type of crimes that we have, it is important. Our officers worked with Sandy, and we're able to get this grant for this, as well as we picked up a second grant that actually paid for all the equipment that goes in the car. There was a state fire marshal's grant that just reimbursed us for training when we hired our newest officers. So total so far since 2014, so in 2.5 years, we brought in over $200,000 in grants. The big significance, because we're on the verge of needing to replace a lot of this equipment. So this, you know, the mindset of these officers using a resident that's willing to help us out is really important to us. Change of culture of the department. We have basically a change because of the restructure of the personnel, the hiring of the new officers. And the officers now, we have the mindset of we want them proactive instead of reactive. I want the officers out. You know, I honestly don't care if the officers sit on Ridge Road or Section Road and think they want to write speeding tickets. That's not what we want in this type of community. If they're out there doing traffic enforcement, that's great. We appreciate that. We like them to do it. But it's just as important to me that they're on the side streets checking the residential areas, checking your cars, checking your driveways, checking your out-of-town houses. That's what we want in this type of community, because when we see the people there that don't belong, it's easier to run them out. But if we sit in the other areas, it doesn't work for us. And then I talked about the change of the impact around us. You know, does it impact us? Yes. Has it impacted us on a crime level? Probably a little bit. I just put the one up here just recently in the beginning of the year that everybody knows about, is with, you know, the recent burglaries. You know, we worked with our detectives worked with the community. We're getting information out because of alert resident making calls, as well as the manager making a call. We're able to apprehend our burglar, and he got 7 years. Where did this guy come from? Down on Reading Road. So it does impact us because they do stroll up to our area. But with that said, talking about it, when you look at these numbers, we usually average anywhere from 125 to about 180 offense reports a year. So if you look at the numbers of 2014, we're at 106, 15, 150, and 2016, we're at 44. Our offense reports range from a car break-in, identity theft, internal theft from whether it be a housekeeper or something else. We don't have a lot of violent activities and things like that where there are actually offense reports. But the significance thing here is the proactive policing. In 2014, we made 312 arrests. 2015, 378. And to date, we made 217. You can see the trend. Having officers that are more proactive out there, stopping the people on the side streets, doing everything they need to do, these reports are going down, but the arrests are going up. And that's what we want to see in this community. Why do we do that? You know, I think it's better for us. How do we do it? We have license plate readers in the cars. We were able to get some on grants. We're looking to buy a couple more. It lets us know if somebody's wanted as they're going through the community. That's really beneficial to us. Like I said before, the proactive policing. And lastly, it's the residents calling in suspicious activity. And anybody that's on Nextdoor or on an email thing, you always see me out there putting stuff. Call it in. If it looks unusual, it probably is. Call it in. We'd rather send an officer out there to find out it's your neighbor or your neighbor's family or friends visiting than find out 3 hours later that we're taking an offense report for a burglary. Has it happened that way? Yes. We've had people go out to friend's house or relative's house, and they don't call it in. They just assume. Don't assume. If it doesn't look right, it's probably not right. Take the time and call, and we'll look at it. If you don't want to give your name, don't give your name. The goals and mission of the department, you know, our goals are to service the community. Well, you know, as a police department, we've always had a mission. We always have a mission statement, and we follow that mission statement. We live by that mission statement. But in reality, you know, our mission statement's not right. Our mission statement needs to be a statement that's formed by the police department and the community. It has to be a joint mission statement. We're providing a service. We work for you, we work for the community, we work for council. We need to know what you guys want from us. What do you expect from us as a police department? Are we providing the right service that you want? Are we doing the things that you want? Are you seeing officers frequent enough? So in the near future, you'll see either an email or something go out asking you, there'll be a few questions, just answer a couple questions, asking you what do you want to see in your police department and different things. And that's where we create our mission statement from. We create it from what you want and what you want to see, and then we work together and we achieve that goal. I think that, you know, we've done an outstanding job as a police department. The cost cutting measures we have done, all the different things, and we're still able to have less personnel, but we're still providing a high level of service, and the number of arrests continue to rise. I think that says a lot about the people we hire. And that's where a lot of this starts. It starts from the people you hire. I give a lot of credit to council. When council comes in there, they're real open in the beginning, and they tell us what they want, what they expect, and they change the culture of how we're thinking about things. Obviously, I'm a new chief, so you know I have a lot to learn, and I know that. But hearing it from council, seeing them do things, and it's relayed from the manager and relayed to us, and when you get buy-in from your organization, buy-in from your officers and your employees, that's what makes a difference in the community. And that's what makes our police department and our community what it is. It's to be able to work together. So this is just, I threw a new picture up of our police department, proud. But I really just want to thank you guys. And if there's something at the end you want to ask, I'll be here afterwards or during a question session. Thanks.
Thank you, Chief. And I'm going to talk a little bit about what Council's been working on with respect to land development in the village. And when I talk about land development for us, I'm going to primarily be talking about these three sites. First of all, Amberley Green. Secondly, the north site, or the former Amberley Swim Club site. And finally, the former Gibson property. With respect to Amberley Green, the property was purchased by Amberley back in, I think, 2008 or 2009. And then in 2011, council approved a long-range plan for the property that basically provided for mixed use, but it also very much stressed that we needed to maximize economic benefit from this property. Now, this was done at a time, the village manager talked about the debt on the property that got repaid in 2012. So when this was put together, council thought, well, we have $6.2 million of debt on this property, so we really need to find a way to maximize economic benefit. But as the manager said, we were fortunate that we were able to pay off the debt. So some of the need for, you know, maximizing the economic benefit was reduced. But the biggest thing that we very much want to focus on is providing value to residents. That could be economic value, it could be an improvement of your lives, it could be some kind of recreational facility or whatever. But that's really driving the way we think of the property. But what, in 2014, having kind of made the decision in 2011 of the long range plan and really nothing happening, council spent 2014 meeting with those in the industry to talk about the property, to try to get a better understanding of what we think might be possible on the property. And what we found, and I, you know, the more we talked about it, it wasn't a big surprise, but the idea of getting a lot of economic benefit off that property, we just didn't feel was realistic. I mean, you're not going to be able to put, you know, a large office building on that property for a lot of reasons, but one of, I mean, there's traffic and other reasons, but also it's probably not what the residents want. That is kind of the center of the village. And historically, Amberley Village has been a community with beautiful properties, a lot of green space and things like that. And this property is in the very much the center of the village. So that kind of toned our thought process a little bit. And so then in 2015, we went out to the industry and said, you know, give us your ideas of what you think is doable on the property, how you would propose to work with the village, and just, you know, let us know so we can consider what you are proposing. Those were received in July of 2015. We spent the remainder of 2015 considering those. Early this year, we made a recommendation out of the Land Development Committee to council to move forward with one of the proposals, but council decided, no, we don't think that's the right time to do this. Let's pause. And so where we are on status today is, in addition to the four proposals we received, we did receive a letter from the Jewish Community Center where we sit today, and the Jewish Community Center is currently very constrained for space for some of the things they want to do. So in that letter that we received in July of 2015, they said, no matter what you do as far as development, we'd like to be included in the discussions. So when council decided in, I think, April of this year, not to move forward at the time, we sat down with the Jewish Community Center again, and what they said at that point is, give us between 90 and 120 days to think about what we might want to do on the property, and then we'll sit down with you. So we're kind of in that phase right now where the Jewish Community Center is considering options. What they've talked about to us to date is the possibility of maybe an outdoor pool up there that might have different membership than is what for the Jewish Community Center here. Definitely some facilities for summer camp for children. They've even talked about things like an amphitheater or some kind of small conference center or something like that. So this is something we will be communicating to residents as we go along. And I assure all of our residents that we will be communicating and discussing these things with you, not only because it makes sense to do it, but we have to. The zoning on this property is something we have to change if we want to do anything on the property. It is currently zoned Residence A, which for Amberley Village means minimum 1 acre residential development. And that is not what we want to do on the property, the residents want to do on the property. That is not something that makes economic sense for the village. And whatever we do on that property has to make economic sense, and has to be that third item under the long-range plan. It has to provide value to the residents, either economic value or improved lifestyle, improve the value of the rest of our properties. It must meet that hurdle. With respect to the north site, the first thing we kind of did, the north site has been a property that council has talked about trying to do something with for quite some time. The old swim club, I think, closed probably about 20 years ago, 15 to 20 years ago. And so that property's been available for doing something with. But the first thing we as council kind of wanted to get clear in our mind is the maintenance facility is currently on that site and takes up about 15 of the 30 acres on that site. So if we were able to do anything with the entire site, we would have to move the maintenance site. So first thing we did as council was discuss that and try to understand what that means. And we very much concluded that we needed to keep the maintenance site on that site. And that is for very practical reasons. If we had to move the maintenance facility, we would have to move it out of the village. That would increase run times, both for things like wood chipping or chipping of the brush, leaf collection, and very importantly, our maintaining our streets in the winter time. And if we increase the run time, we would probably have to increase staff. It just did not make economic sense to do that, especially when you considered the cost of moving it. So that's kind of a decision that we kind of set aside. Then in 2014, we went through a rezoning process on that particular site. And the site is now zoned to allow us to do something from a commercial sense. It previously was zoned residential, but it is now zoned appropriately. We then listed the remaining 14 acres on the site, and in 2015, we did enter into a contract with someone who said that they would buy the site, but the purchase was subject to due diligence, and part of that due diligence was them going out to the market and to better understand what is doable on that site. We're still in that kind of phase as far as due diligence, so it is still under contract, but we are also still free to do other things on the site, so we do continue to pursue other options. It is clearly a site that has its challenges. As you go through that intersection down there, getting in and out of that site at certain times of the day, for instance, after Mount Notre Dame gets out at 3 o'clock, can be a real challenge, and also at rush hour. And we did recently do a traffic study for that particular site, and it very much confirmed what we pretty much knew, that there really isn't much capacity at that site. So that's one of our big challenges to have to deal with. On the former Gibson property, the village manager mentioned that Saturday Night Limited has vacated the property. Now, Saturday Night Limited vacated the property because they could not come to agreement with the owner of the property on terms. Amberley Village was not involved in those discussions. However, as we sit here today, I think from a village standpoint, it's probably a great outcome. Now, Saturday Night Limited did employ 75 people on the property, but it did not really provide much earnings base to Amberley Village. And when you think of 75 employees on a site of 53 acres, and on a site that when Gibson was there, was providing $1 million a year to Amberley Village, if we can get something much better done on that property in the long term, that is a much better answer for the village. So the village manager has been working prior to the Port Authority getting interested in the property last fall, but has been working diligently with the current owner of the property to try to identify a better use of that particular property. You probably have seen in the press that the Port Authority has entered into a contract to buy the property. That is expected to close this month. Their first action is to then, they will go through demolition on the building on the property. The building has been determined that it just does not make sense for the type of tenants that they want to attract to that property. And this is all part of the Port Authority's strategic initiative to look at trying to attract in the I-75 corridor light manufacturing to that particular corridor. When they heard about the Gibson site being available, they became very excited because it was a case where they could, in one step, acquire 53 acres in an ideal location. It's a great place for the I-75 corridor, especially if we can do certain things to get better access onto some of the streets which we are looking at. So part of this initiative, the way that they are generating their equity to make these purchases is they've gone out to the market to, you know, large companies, to construction companies, to demolition companies, and things like that, and ask them to make equity investments. But as part of that, they've also told these equity investors, we expect to be able to get your money back to you within a very short time, and they've talked about a 5-year time frame. So they are very confident that they will be able to turn this property over, and this is the first case in their strategic initiative. So I think they are very committed to making this a real success, and their real success will definitely translate into success for the village. So as far as the next steps for Amberley, we will be having some discussions with the Port Authority on zoning. The zoning on that property, the vast majority of that property is zoned fine. But on the hillside, which I call the sled riding hillside, that is currently zoned residence, and that is something that the Port Authority wants to talk to us about. We also, as I said, will be working with the Port Authority and the Regional Development Initiative to look at, you know, the best type tenants for that property. And in fact, there are already some particular prospects identified. So again, it is something that probably, you know, we're not going to see revenues for, you know, 3 years or something, but I think in the long term, this is a very, very positive story for the village. As far as we put this slide up, if you need to contact the village manager, the police chief, myself, even council members, the council member contacts are on the website. Our contacts are there, so please feel free to contact us at any time. Now, just a couple other things before we get into question and answers. When you came in the door this evening, there were papers to sign up for do not solicit list. So I hope you put your names on those lists. The reason we've had to go to a do not solicit list, if you go back, you know, just a few years, you would come into the village and there would be the small sign that says you cannot solicit in the village. Well, it was determined that under new Ohio law that we could no longer have a law that just prohibited solicitation, that people had a right to solicit, but that you could require anyone that wanted to solicit to register in your community, and you could in fact have a do not solicit list. So when we get requests in for people to solicit in the community, we give them the do not solicit list. So if your name and address, and in fact I think it is just addresses, your names will not be on the do not solicit list. If your address is on that, you will not be solicited. So if you're not interested in being solicited, please get your name on that. I also want to mention that the village has a mobile app for both iPhone and Android users. So if you want to get access to us, please use that mobile app. You can also like us on Facebook and Twitter. And Councilwoman Conway, you want to mention something about the gas pipeline? Yeah, go ahead.
Seen different things on Nextdoor, maybe in the local press, regarding Duke's proposal to install a 12-mile transmission, natural gas transmission line that would start up in the northern suburbs and go along one of three routes down to either Norwood or Fairfax. It's a 30-inch line. It's a transmission line, which is very different than the lines that we have in existence now to provide natural gas to our homes. People who lived along original proposed route received notices back in February inviting them to a series of, well, there were two options for an open house to meet with Duke representatives and get more information, but it, at that point it was not really widely disseminated outside of the immediate homeowners along the route. And so many people thought the letter was junk mail and didn't know much about it. A group that's now calling itself NOPE, Neighbors Opposed to Pipeline Extension, began on a little street in Blue Ash, people talking to each other and saying, you know, we don't really like this, we don't want this in our community. One of the three routes would go significantly through Blue Ash. Two of them would go through Amberley. One now would look like it would go down Ridge Road. Another, the other one on the green line goes to on the west side of the village. But those routes are not set in stone at any point, anyhow. But these neighbors got together and began studying the issue and trying to prevent their own street from being dug up. But in reality, the more they learned that they really didn't want it anywhere in a highly populated area, because if there were to be, well, first of all, the installation process can involve significant disruption. It requires a very large right-of-way, 15 feet on each side, and no plantings permitted along that right-of-way. So imagine if that pipe were to go down Ridge Road, what that would do to our village. And the other thing is the ongoing risks of having that kind of pipe in our neighborhoods by schools and houses of worship and businesses, et cetera. So they began activating amongst their own community, and then it's now spreading out to the other neighborhoods where the pipe line is proposed. So there have been several meetings already. Amberley's Environmental Stewardship Committee held a meeting back a couple weeks ago, and people began to be informed. There was a town hall in Blue Ash a week or two ago. There is going to be another town hall led by, again, neighbors from this next Thursday at the Golf Manor Community Center. Right, I don't know what they call it. It's on Weehee Road. I posted the address on Nextdoor today. If I don't have it ready to hand. It's at their village hall. And Duke is also having another open house on Wednesday, June 15th. At the Cooper Creek Event Center between 5 and 8 p.m. It's an open house, you don't come for the whole time. And I've heard that there will be representatives from the Ohio Power Siting Board present at that meeting. Main thing right now is to keep telling people about it, tell your neighbors, educate yourself, form your opinion, and then speak up by writing to the Power Siting Board, writing to some legislators, expressing your viewpoint. It's really a state process. There is a role for local governments. You're going to talk about that. Tom's going to tell us about that. But the bottom line is, I just want to encourage everyone to inform yourself and take action if you feel so moved. It's really a big, big thing.
Yeah, I mean, as far as local government, the first thing we really wanted to focus on was ensuring that our residents had the information that they needed to better understand this project. So we've put information on our website. We've been sending information out via newsletters and things like that. And then, as was mentioned, the Environmental Stewardship Committee met a week and a half ago and discussed this. The Environmental Stewardship Committee has issued a letter to the Ohio Power Siting Board. And it is the Ohio Power. Well, the process is Duke is in kind of a pre-filing stage right now, and they're expected that, they, as was mentioned, they're considering three routes. At the end of this month, they're expected to make their filing with the Ohio Power Siting Board, and in that they will name a preferred route and one backup. So they drop down to two routes. And then the Ohio Power Siting Board goes through its regulatory process. So it is very much focused at the state, but there's already lots of comments being sent to the Ohio Power Siting Board. I looked earlier today, there's already 210 comments in, and this really is where the power of the individual is. I mean, I've sent a letter in, a number of the other council members, we as council are considering a resolution opposing the pipeline, but it really is very much focused on the individuals. There are things that we can do as a community, but it's important that individuals also put in their 2 cents worth, and that's really where we are in the process. It is something that generally, when these things are done, they don't go through, you know, densely populated areas because, you know, either the pipeline was put in long before development was in, or they try to stay in rural areas, and we just don't think this is a good idea. But I encourage people to get their comments in to either the Power Siting Board. Our state representative, Denise Driehaus, has sent a comment into the Power Siting Board, sent her a letter, and State Representative Deaver from like Madeira and others has also sent in letters opposing it. So there are, you know, a lot going on this, but, you know, please get involved. So I will now move on to questions and answers. But first I want to mention that we have a number of staff around. Wes Brown, who really deals with kind of our permitting process, et cetera, is over here, and we'll have a microphone. Nicole Browder, who was at the table when you came in and is our county clerk, and Kathleen Harcourt is our finance director, and she's in the back. So if you have a question, they will get the microphone to you so you can stay at your seat. So we will now move on to question and answers.
Yes, and I live in the Elmwood subdivision. First of all, thank you for a wonderful presentation, all three of you. It is just terrific to see the transparency and the information that's being portrayed tonight. I want to speak a little bit about the concern of the Port Authority taking over the former Gibson site. On the one hand, it'll be good, it'll generate all sorts of revenue. On the other hand, for those of us that live in the Elbrook subdivision, we already are getting occasional large trucks that are coming down the street, come on my cul-de-sac street, turn around on our lawns, creating all sorts of problems. Even though there are signs that regulate that big trucks are not supposed to go there, they are. Even though we have signs on the entry into Section Road stating the axle weight limit, we know that there are trucks coming through on Section Road that exceed that limit. So as you talk with the Port Authority, what are we going to do to protect the residential nature of that portion of the village that is residential?
A couple comments. I mean, first of all, now that Saturday Night Limited out of there for this intervening period, hopefully that will not be an issue. But I do think, you know, one of the things that we're trying to look at opportunities to get better access to that property via Reading Road. And Sunningdale? Sunnybrook. That goes by the PepsiCo plant, which is, again, a Amberley business. If we can get access via Sunnybrook right out to Reading, then I think that will alleviate a lot of that potential. And we are in discussions about that. I clearly think this is something that us being involved with the Port Authority, with any prospects, these are the kind of things that we can very much stress to any potential prospect, that we do have a residential neighborhood and they really need to respect that. And if we need to put, you know, more signage up or something like that, it is something that we will strive to make sure that our residents on Elbrook are not interfered with. Next question.
First of all, I'd also like to congratulate the presentation, but I really wanted to zero in on what the police department has been fabulous with my personal situation, having a chronically ill wife who passed away, runs every week to take her to the hospital, then a son who was drug involved. Many residents of Amberley had to deal with that, and the police department literally, I think, saved his life and my life. So I really want to commend their approach. It could have been, you know, either a lot harsher or a lot lighter, but it was, you know, it was wake-up calls for us. And what I was trying to, the question in that venue is about the heroin interdiction force. How is Amberley involved with that? Have the dealers been cleaned up in Golf Manor and Rose Lawn, which was our primary source of heroin? That's my question.
Thanks for the fine, the nice comments. The heroin, how are we connected to the Heroin Coalition? Well, I'm the vice president of the Hamilton County Police Chiefs Association. So the board that I'm on actually is the board that put the Heroin Coalition together. So they're actually, they operate and function underneath the direction of myself and the president, Scott Snow. So we're pretty involved in it. We get weekly updates. We distribute all the information to all the agencies. And what we did, we have a program in place that if there's any heroin overdoses or deaths in our community or other communities, we actually forward those to the team. They take the information and they actually work the cases backwards, and they work with the prosecutor's office and they attempt to make the arrests on the dealers. As for the heroin dealers around here, are there heroin dealers? Yes. Are they going to go away? No, not right now. We make arrests. If you look at a lot of our arrests we make, it involves heroin. It's the most common thing now. We're going to be dealing with it for some time. All we can do is get a hold of it the best we can for now.
Do you know if there's anybody interested in the Sunnybrook property?
You're referring to Temple Shalom? Oh, the Procter & Gamble property. Currently, they have an operation that will continue in the Procter & Gamble facility. So there actually were two operations in the P&G facility. The couponing and fraud is what is being outsourced to Milford. There's another portion of it, which is called fulfillment. So it's an opportunity where if a particular store wants to display product, that product is being put together there at the Procter & Gamble facility. That will continue, and they are evaluating what they're going to do with the facility. So no decisions have been made at this time.
Could you give me more of an explanation of the Port Authority? Is it not a government operation? And how is it going to function with private businesses, et cetera?
Well, the Hamilton County Port Authority is a separate entity. It is a government entity. It's a public entity. And it receives its funding through a variety of sources. And what they'll be doing with the property here in the village is they will be leveraging their dollars with State of Ohio dollars in order to do the demolition of the former Gibson property. So they're its own board. They have a board of directors there that advise them, and they also have different other committees that look at different aspects of trying to accomplish their mission. But they do operate independently, and we are certainly interfacing with them to secure this acquisition. Does that answer your question? All right, thank
you. Good evening. My name is Barbara Bowles. I live on Amber Creek Drive. I have a concern about the appearance of the pavement. You know, it seems like it's been patched with some tar or something, but I was wondering if there's a plan in place to improve the pavement.
And that is specifically on Amber Creek Drive?
It's Bowman and Amber Creek.
Yeah, what you're probably referring to is the what we call crack ceiling. And while it doesn't look so great, it is a necessary preventative measure to prevent the pavement from deteriorating. So what happens with pavement is as the pavement continues to its useful life, it begins cracking and water gets down into the cracks. And when water gets down into the cracks on pavement, that's when you get potholes. And then the street completely deteriorates. So what our maintenance department does each year, and typically it occurs in the late summer, early fall, is we begin our annual crack sealing program, where we actually go out and we blow out the crack to get the debris out of the crack that's in the street, and then we put tar into the crack, and then we put a little bit, we usually throw something over it so it doesn't tack to your tires. It is a little bit tacky for the first 24 hours or so, and once again, it doesn't look good, but it does an incredible job of maintaining the integrity of the street. So when we are doing crack filling, that could be a street that may only have been repaved in the last few years, or it may be a street that's upwards to anywhere from 5 to 14 years old in terms of its useful life. But as that street matures, that crack filling material holds it together, but as the street continues to deteriorate at some point in time, that's when we will come back in and do additional work. But you shouldn't be alarmed by the crack filling, because that's a good thing to see on your street, even though aesthetically it does not look good.
My name is Joshua Bradley. I live down in Millbrook. Back to the Port Authority, you mentioned there's going to be demolition. What kind of demolition are we talking about? I know the property itself, I'm saying, like, what type of, like, you know, noise level and.
The Port Authority intends to demolish the entire building.
Right, I'm saying, what are they going to be doing? Like, how are they doing that exactly? Do you know yet? In regards to, like, you know, wrecking ball, plastic caps?
We will find out for sure exactly what it is, and we will make sure that probably via the e-news that we make especially residents on Elbrook, etc., understand what to expect.
I'm Gary Albert, I live in Warrenfield. You were talking about the north side and of course the traffic up there. Part of the traffic is not just about the four lanes and less than a tenth of a mile, but it's also the bridge. Is there any chance that the state is going to at least widen the bridge enough that we can have turn lanes? Obviously, if you don't widen the road, widening the bridge doesn't do a whole lot of good. But at least we can have some turn lanes, which might make things a little bit easier.
Yeah, this has been an item that we have had quite a few discussions on. I mean, there's a lot of challenges associated with that particular intersection. You have lots of entities involved, you know, because you've got Ronald Reagan there, ODOT, the Ohio Department of Transportation, is involved, but all the lights there are actually controlled by Reading, and the lights are timed in a manner that. One could say it benefits those coming out of Reading. and we have, I think, the idea of widening the bridge, that would be major money. But there's a lot of things going on right now. I don't know if you're aware, but the city of Reading is going to be consolidating their elementary school, their middle school, and their high school at the high school campus. Oh, they went through a bond levy in November of 2015 and passed that levy with state money also. So there's going to be a lot of construction over the next couple of years constructing that. That will have traffic impact. I always, in my mind, most of that traffic should go the other direction since the bulk of the Reading residents, you know, go the other way, but it will have an impact. So it is something we are looking at. I think the idea of widening the bridge is one that I don't put a lot of hope on. Getting a left turn lane signal, we have a left turn lane, a left turn signal heading northbound out of Amberley onto Ronald Reagan is something we've talked about. So there are things that we're going to pursue, but none of them are easy. So.
With the Port Authority's acquisition of the property, the only thing that's changed is the ownership, okay? And so the village does not notify adjacent property owners if there's just a change in ownership. The only way that the village would notify adjacent property owners would be if there is a zone change. Now, what the mayor mentioned earlier is that they will be requesting a zone change on the residential piece that's on the front of the property around Section Road, and it also fronts a little bit of the Elbrook piece. So there will be a rezoning request coming, and you will get notified of that if you're adjacent property owner or within 1,000 feet, I believe. So that's where you will get your notification in regards to that. So that the next step in their process will be to request the rezoning. There's, at this point, we do not know what's going to be built on the property. Currently, there's a footprint for the building, but they will be demolishing that building. But I don't know at this point what the prospect will be or who that will be in terms of what kind of square footage they're going to need. Do they need more space? Do they need less? That is an unknown. Part of the process that the mayor referred to, us working with the Port Authority and also with the Regional Economic Development Initiative, is to go out and recruit a business to come into that site or multiple businesses to come into that site. And then that's when we would end up getting site plan for whatever needs to be built, and then that would go through our process for approval. But the next step is going to be the zoning change on the what the mayor calls the sledding hill.
So I think whenever we had a meeting previously, you had talked about the fact that the building can't be a certain height and the lighting, you know, so there are a ton of concerns, even though they are demolishing the structure that's there. I do have concerns over the timing of the day of when they're going to be demolishing, the noise, the trucks coming in and out. Exactly what are they demolishing? Are they just demolishing? back there. Mm-hmm. So the more you can get us when you know it, the more transparent you can be, it will make us much more comfortable.
That's a good point. And at this point, we have limited information because they've not acquired it yet. But as they work with us, I know that they'll be pursuing the rezoning. There are actually some public streets that go into that property, which is odd because I believe they are paper streets, and those have to be vacated. They will likely be doing something with stormwater. You know, there is a lot of pavement to the north of the building there, and it's likely that they'll be trying to do something to improve that area because there's a significant amount of stormwater that comes from in that area, primarily off of Elbrook. So there are a lot of moving pieces, but certainly we only know a limited amount at this time, but as the port moves forward and as we march towards getting a prospect for that site, that's when that information will become available to us.
Okay. I mean, I assume that through the port, we can meet with the company that's doing demolition to discuss things like keeping the dust down and what they might be able to do for noise, et cetera. So we'll be able to sit down with the company.
Yes.
Bob Maltz, ear, nose, and throat doctor. I have a comment to make about the demolition, but I'm coming at it from a different viewpoint. From a healthcare standpoint, I don't know if the village has thought about this, but when the building is demolished, it's going to create a lot of dust in the air, and the air currents are going to carry that dust probably for miles, and so you might want to think about some way to contain that dust, otherwise there are going to be a lot of chronic pulmonary problems and some serious side effects from that dust. You know, this is, in a tiny way, if you think about 9/11 and the pictures of the people running away from all the dust and from that was being created by that. But this would be a much, obviously, smaller, but still it is a consideration.
I appreciate that comment. We are working with the Port Authority. We just met on the site just a few weeks ago about the security of the property because obviously, as was indicated, Saturday Night Limited has vacated the building. So the next step is to for the port to secure the building during the period of time that it's going to be in their possession. So they do have a security firm that is on top of the building, will be occupying the building for that purpose. And then the demolition, as I've talked to them about the demolition, it's obvious to me that the demolition is down the road. I mean, although that's one of the first things they want to accomplish, they're not ready to embark on demolition or to talk about those plans yet. But as those plans become available to us, then that's when we'll have the opportunity to provide input to them about the concerns of residents. I know that we have made them aware of the sensitivity of this site, how close it is to some of the houses on Elbrook, so they're very much aware of that. And we've also encouraged them to make sure that, because we know there would likely be some materials in that building that they're gonna need to contain. So they're already on top of that, but they're not ready to have that discussion because they're still in the due diligence period. They're also, they've not acquired the building yet, but so once they jump those particular hurdles, then we will move on to the next. So it might feel a little bit piecemeal at this time, but it'll gradually get to that point. But certainly appreciate the comments in regards to the demolition.
Thank you. Patricia Hsu, I live on Winding Way. You mentioned the green space. Several years ago, there was quite a conflict of the property, and I came to every one of the meetings. I was really impressed with the residents wanting to keep it a green space. That was the big fight at the time. There was total disregard for the person who wanted to develop it. Mr. Silverman, I do believe he changed the plans three times trying to rectify and solve the problem of development as residential, and you mentioned that that's what it is, zoned as residential. No matter what plans he presented, which would have been a source of income to Amberley Village, since that is the last prime piece of property in Amberley. And the whole issue was over traffic. The traffic is right here coming out of the Jewish Community Center, hooked up with Reading. So this building and this property and this business adds to the problem of traffic. And that was the main thing there was, oh, don't build residential. Is because we're going to have traffic, and we do not want traffic, and we want a green space. Well, eons ago in Amberley, my family has been here since 1945. The city turned down, or village turned down French Park, which was offered to Amberley, and you didn't want it. Now you are talking about development again. Now you are talking about development, and what was it besides the Jewish community here, which if they were given the property, would not be any revenue to the village again, and it would indeed be traffic once more. So that was the big fight over that. And to me, Amberley needs revenue. And if you're going to do anything, then build. Build it residential and leave it thus. You mentioned not only the Jewish community, what other businesses were interested in that piece of property? What other people contacted you in regard to buying that property, please?
First of all, the proposal was not on buying the property. What we wanted to do was sit down with people and talk about their ideas on development, what potentially they could do on the property. There were four parties that submitted proposals. They were all groups. One was called Amberley Development Partners, and that was made up of a group of some Amberley residents and some other investors. One was called, there was a group of really more consultants that had gotten together and said that they would be good, you know, they would consult with us and come up with a plan. There was a group of who's the house developer?
Great Traditions.
There was Dove Limited, which was also had a resident in it, and also some home developments, etc. And then there was a Great Traditions home development was also. Now, with respect to home development on that property, most studies say that home development in and of itself does not pay for itself. It does not generate any revenue because it causes additional cost in order to maintain the streets, provide policing, etc. Now there are certain forms of housing development where they're a little bit more densely put in that can pay for themselves. But you know, the housing development that was originally proposed on that property, which was 1 acre development, would probably not have paid for itself. That's what all studies said. So, you know, the property has challenges, traffic being one, et cetera. It's a property that is in decay right now. It is very much, when you go out on that property right now, people that walk the property, you know, there's a lot of trees that are dying. There's trees that are coming down. The old cart paths are very much in decay that people use for walking paths. We want to do something smart on the property, but it has to generate, it cannot be a net cost to the village. It has to generate revenue. That's one of our requirements as a council. We said we cannot afford anything of additional cost. We want to do something that does maintain green space. You know, it is something that is going to, it's going to be, it is a large parcel of land. It's a beautiful parcel of land, but it's going to be one that we don't want to rush into. We want to take it very slow because we want to get it right. And if that means, you know, that we have to wait a few years or 5 years to get something right, and or do something in a phased approach more, you know, 10 acres here, 20 acres there. We will do that because, you know, we want to do something that, that is right for our residents, that generates the revenue. And I do want to add, we want to do something that avoids a lot of negativity like there was around back in 2007 or 6 or whatever that was. And that's why we want to very much include residents in the conversation. And it, you know, it was the court that mandated it be zoned Residence A. That's what the court battle that was waged. We were mandated to zone it. But I actually feel really good about the fact that we were mandated to zone it Residence A, because we know we can't do anything on that property that our residents want without having the right conversations. So it is something you will be hearing about, but it will be a slow process.
My name is John Field, Amberley Village, 46 years. Some people see empty land and they think development. Others think beauty of space. I like it the way it is. If you develop it, though, it's 132 acres, and one of the plans recommended 92 single residences. The traffic, something that was open and beautiful and made us look special instead of being a housing project. And I even wonder how many houses got the settlement now in Amberley without the school district, that this would be viable property. Please do everything you can to keep the beautiful site.
Kurt Brunswick, I just wanted, as you talk about this site, I wanted more clarity on what you mean by the value and the revenue, because we pay a certain amount of money, I'm sure, today to at least mow the grass, and there's cost associated with it. So is there a target you've set, and, you know, at a minimum, it's paid off, but is the target to pay for all the operating expenses or off, at least offset those? Because as I see it right now, it's a beautiful site. It's great to have green space, but you know, we also have French Park, and for me, I can walk from my backyard over to there, and I use it a lot. So I've never been to Amberley Green. I know a lot of people have, but right now we have a site that's open and beautiful, but it's generating zero revenue. So what is the revenue target, and is it, you know, is it not to increase the current cost we're paying, or is it to offset those completely, or is it that plus some more?
Yeah, the current cost, I mean, we do have some utilities on the property. As you mentioned, we do mow the grass. The cost of mowing the grass is amazingly inexpensive from my perspective. I think it's $25,000 on an annual basis. So I was shocked when I heard that it wasn't more, but when you consider all costs, the total cost of that property, I want to say, is around $100,000 right now. It clearly is not paying for itself right now. We do not have any kind of revenue target or anything like that. I mean, we don't, I would say the biggest thing we want to do is, because it is the center of the village, and it is, the village, I think, prides itself on a lot of green space, a lot of beautiful property, and, you know, we hope there's some things that we can do on that property that will generate some revenues and make our residents' lives better. But we don't know specifically what it is that we're going to do, but we are not going to do anything that would increase cost to the village, because that is something we just cannot afford to do. I am concerned with the condition of the property. I think it is a great asset. I walk French Park all the time because I live across the street from it, but I do go down to Amberley Green. There are people using it for community gardening and so forth. So it is getting more and more use, but I'm concerned that given the condition of it, that in 3-4 years time, we won't be able to let people out there. And I just don't want that to happen. I want it to be an asset to our residents in some form that our residents can use and get the benefit of, either be that economic benefit, recreational benefit, or something. But we've got a lot of work to do to understand what that is and be able to communicate with residents and discuss it with residents. It's not going to be a one-way communication. It's going to have to be a two-way communication as we move forward. And it is going to take a lot of time. Any other questions? All right, I very much thank you for your input, and I appreciate the concerns with the demolition. We will very much focus on that. And we will continue to hold these types of sessions where we provide you the information, because we really do want to be, as it was mentioned earlier, open and transparent. And we are starting to experiment with some other things that give greater transparency to our financial information, et cetera. So it is something we are committed to. Thank you very much.